right to Don. CNN Tonight starts now.
He lied about the lies that he lied about.
It's indeed.
Yeah, he did. It's like, well, let me tell you why I lied. And even in those statements, there is some factual errors in the statement as well. To me, it's just, I think it has been sort of accepted that this president lies and kind of and normalized in a way. And that is bothersome, no matter who the president is. But that's just bothersome to me and what it does to the fabric of our society.
From the beginning, I took a lot of heat because you're calling out lies. Maybe they matter, maybe they don't, but it's so pejorative. Lying is the basis of all criminal prosecution
right. And
political upheaval.
Yeah.
He has been lying about things. It is now becoming a matter of fact in terms of the understanding of what happened around him with respect to Russian interference.
Mm-hmm.
There is going to be trouble ahead.
We're saying, they were private transactions, right? Speaking of the payments.
You're talking about the payments to the women.
To Karen McDougal, to the women. Mm-hmm. But then, if they were private transactions, why didn't he disclose them, right? And then he comes back to try to explain why he didn't, and then he lied about it. And then why keep lying about the Trump Tower thing, knowing that somehow, I don't know, I don't get it. I don't get how so much lying is acceptable. It's just not for me. I know that politicians have issues with the truth sometimes, but this is on steroids, Chris. I mean, it's outrageous.
Mueller is going to give us a set of facts, but then the game begins.
Yeah.
And what happens with those facts, I believe, and again, I could be wrong. Nobody will have more fun with that proposition than you. But if I'm wrong, I'm wrong. If I'm right, it means what politicians will be a function of what people want them to do. And it's going to be a big burden, and we haven't had one like it in a long time.
Well, I think public opinion is going to shape a lot of this, whether people believe it or not, and that is what he's banking on. But the truth is the truth is the truth, and people should dig down within themselves and think about it. If you're a Trump supporter, how would you feel if Barack Obama had done the same thing, or Bill Clinton, or even George W. Bush, if they had done the exact same thing, how would you feel? I think they would be feeling a whole lot differently than they feel about this, because nothing seems to matter right now. Truth doesn't matter unless the truth only matters for Trump supporters when it's a Democrat.
Well, but that's not the truth.
Yeah.
And look, it could cut both ways. For the Democrats, this is a daunting proposition. What do you do with your power? And, you know, because it's not too long until 2020.
Yeah.
You know, we have another election a couple years from now.
Wait now. They should wait. They have time. Wait to see if something actually does transpire. And again, you don't want, you know, talk about impeachment if it's not a real possibility. You want to get on with the business of the American people. And that is ultimately what will keep you in good stead with the American
Nancy
people.
Pelosi said the same thing to me the day after the election.
Thank you, sir. I'll see you tomorrow.
Yes, sir.
This is CNN Tonight. I'm Don Lemon. President Trump, out of sight, staying behind closed doors inside the White House today. But we know what's on his mind. Breaking news tonight. A source is telling CNN that the president has expressed concern that he could be impeached when the Democrats take control of the House in January. Okay? And also tonight, 44 former U.S. senators writing an op-ed in the Washington Post. Here it is. They are warning that the country is entering what they call a dangerous period, and calling on current senators to zealously guard our democracy. They say they feel an obligation to speak up about serious challenges to the rule of law, to the Constitution, our governing institutions, and our national security. When have you heard of anything like that? This is at the same time as prosecutors for the first time implicate President Trump, implicate him in possible criminal activity, accusing him as a candidate for office of directing his former personal lawyer and fixer, Michael Cohen, to pay hush money to buy the silence of two women who claimed to have had an affair with Trump. Prosecutors writing in the Cohen document this, as Cohen himself has now admitted with respect to both payments, he acted in coordination with and at the direction of individual one. You know who prosecutors say is individual one? They identify him as Donald Trump. The president lashing out at the accusations this morning in a tweet, misspelling, by the way, the word smoking, and here's what he writes. He says, Democrats can't find a smoking gun tying the Trump campaign to Russia after James Comey's testimony. No smoking gun, no collusion. That's because there was no collusion. So now the Dems go to a simple private transaction, wrongly call it a campaign contribution, which it was not. Lawyer's liability if he made a mistake, not me. Cohen just trying to get his sentence reduced. All right, there's a lot in there, but, and we'll talk about it. So let's break down some of what he is claiming there, okay? He's admitting payments were made. Now he's admitting it, he didn't before. But he is admitting payments were made to Stormy Daniels and Karen McDougal, but he is dismissing them as simple private transactions. There's always an excuse for money. And he can't keep his story straight. So remember when he lied about the payments requested by reporters on the airport back in the spring? Okay, well, here's what prosecutors have to say about it. In their court filing, they flat out call the payments illegal campaign contributions. Illegal campaign contributions. I want you to listen to this closely because this has been bugging me for the last few days when I just want to scream at the television when I see it. President Trump and his apologists, okay, if you're one of them, listen, working very hard to claim that this is business as usual. And even if it wasn't, it's just like what Obama did during his campaign. That is a flat-out lie. Legal experts will agree. Do a fact check, will you? And let me give you some now. And we'll talk about it more in the show. The Obama campaign did miss filing deadlines and did not promptly refund excess contributions, which they admitted, and they paid the fines. Some of my guests will tell you campaigns are fined for doing that all the time. Sometimes there are clerical errors, sometimes there are other reasons. That is not the same at all as creating a shell company or using a media company to pay hush money for affairs with a porn star and a Playboy model during an election so that the public, the voting public, wouldn't find out. It is not the same at all. Come on. Don't be stupid. Don't think that people are stupid by pretending that this is equal and the same thing. It is not. Democrats who are about to take over key House investigative committees with subpoena power, issuing warnings to the president. Listen.
They would be impeachable offenses. Whether they are important enough to justify an impeachment is a different question, but certainly they'd be impeachable offenses.
My takeaway is there's a very real prospect that on the day Donald Trump leaves office, the Justice Department may indict him, that he may be the first president in quite some time to face the real prospect of jail time.
So after Robert Mueller and the New York prosecutors filed their sentencing documents on Friday, President Trump incredibly tweeted this message. Totally clears the president. Thank you. I can't say that again. Totally clear as a president. Thank you. How he came to that conclusion is mind-boggling. The filings say nothing of the kind. And Mueller points out that Michael Cohen was working on the Trump Tower Moscow project well into June of 2016 and keeping Trump in the loop about it. When Trump basically had the GOP nomination in hand and the Russians were interfering in the election. But as usual, President Trump's deflecting, saying this at the White House on Saturday.
On the Mueller situation, we're very happy with what there never has been. The last thing I want is help from Russia on a campaign.
That is an interesting statement, especially in light of reporting that now shows at least 16 associates Donald Trump had contacts with Russians during the 2016 campaign and the transition period following Trump's election victory. And remember, Russia, go on you if you know the emails, send them out. did need Russia's help, though. The walls are closing in, and we can expect Trump's tweets to get even more, even angrier and more unhinged. And if that's not enough, tonight a source is telling CNN that accused Russian spy Maria Butina is cooperating with federal prosecutors as part of a plea deal. A plea deal where she admits to spying in the U.S. for Russia. Max Boot is here. He's with me to talk about that in just a few minutes. Okay? Also tonight, though, the president has another immediate problem. He needs to find a new chief of staff and is said to be super pissed. That's a quote. Because the person he wanted for the job, Vice President Pence's chief of staff, Nick Ayers, said no. The president didn't have a backup plan and is now starting the search from scratch, all over again. He wants someone in place soon, someone with political savvy. Word is from the White House is that the President Trump is becoming increasingly concerned about Democrats taking over the House come January with all their oversight and subpoena power at the ready. So there is a whole lot to get to, but we begin with the news that accused Russian spy Maria Butina is cooperating with federal prosecutors as part of a plea deal. So let's bring in Max Boot. He's the author of The Corrosion of Conservatism, Why I Left the Right. Max, thank you so much. What kind of information could Butina provide to American investigators?
Well, it's very interesting, Don. I mean, this really seems like something out of a sequel to The Manchurian Candidate, but this is fact, not fiction. And the reality is, Robert Mueller has already indicted 25 Russians on charges of interfering in the U.S. election, but Maria Butina is the first one who is actually in U.S. custody and who is cooperating with American prosecutors, so it's quite possible that she could shed more light on what the Russians were up to, especially because she was quite close to Alexander Torshin, who was the deputy governor of the Russian Central Bank and somebody who was close to Putin and was somebody who was focused on infiltrating the NRA and through the NRA Republican politics.
I want to play this for you. This is a clip of Butina asking then candidate Donald Trump, right, a question. It was at a campaign event in 2015. Here it is.
I'm visiting from Russia.
Ah,
so my question.
Putin. Good friend of Obama, Putin.
My
he
question.
He likes Obama a lot. Go ahead.
If you would be elected as a president, what will be your foreign politics, especially in the relationships with my country? And do you want to continue the politics of sanctions that are damaging of both economy? Or you have any other ideas?
Okay. Obama gets along with nobody. The whole world hates us. I know Putin, and I'll tell you what, we'd get along with Putin. I believe I would get along very nicely with Putin. Okay? Mm-hmm.
So she asks if sanctions will continue, which is pretty clearly a major foreign policy goal for Russia, right?
Right. Very bizarre situation where you wonder if that was a setup with her asking that question. But it just points to the fact that there was a massive Russian penetration of American politics and specifically of the Republican Party. And Maria Butina was part of that operation.
And we have to remember at the same
campaign. I mean, imagine if we had known that the Trump high command was meeting with Russians who were promising dirt on Hillary Clinton right before they actually started leaking dirt through WikiLeaks. I mean, that is highly suggestive. And so is the fact that Trump and his aides have consistently lied about that, and not just lied about it, but Donald Trump has also obstructed justice to stop the investigation of what happened. So, I mean, you can't imagine a more nefarious or suggestive set of facts, Don.
I want to read this because this is, and get your reaction to this. Yeah. This is a letter by 44 Democratic and Republican former senators in the Washington Post tonight, okay? And they write, Max, whatever united or divided us, we did not veer from our unwavering and shared commitment to placing our country, democracy, and national interest above all else. At other critical moments in our history, when constitutional crises have threatened our foundations, it has been the Senate that has stood in defense of our democracy. Today is once again such a time. What are the former senators getting at here, you think? What would it look like for the Senate to stand up for the rule of law?
Well, for starters, they should pass the bill protecting Robert Mueller from being fired by Donald Trump. But I think more broadly, I think what we're seeing is evidence potentially of high crimes and misdemeanors for which the House would certainly be willing to impeach Donald Trump if they thought that there was any chance of removing him in the Senate. And so the question becomes, will senators examine the evidence fairly and on the merits, or will the Republican senators put their clearly, these former senators.
I'm going to start with you. I just want to get your reaction to these 44 former U.S. senators from both parties warning that, quote, we are entering a dangerous period of the Senate must stand in defense of democracy. I mean, that's quite a wake-up call, isn't it?
Is that the new Don? Okay. I was found that letter stunning. It's an amazing story. 44 former members of the Senate wrote to the incumbents. And I think they really are directing it to the majority leader. I think they're telling him, get, I do. And I think they're telling him, stop all this nonsense and start standing up and talking about what this country's about.
Neil, let me read some of it and then get your reaction.
But don't
this is part of their offer. This is part of affiliation, ideological meaning, or geography. As former members of this great body, we urge current and future senators to be steadfast and zealous guardians of our democracy by ensuring that partisanship or self-interest not replace national interest. Can it be done, given the extreme partisanship we see now?
Well, holy smocks, Don. When I read that, tears actually came to my eyes because, I mean, I really have been saying this for a long time. So many others. And, to have a letter like this, and it's signed not just by Democrats, but by Jack Danforth, one of the kind of most esteemed members of the Republican Party serving in the Senate, it's welcome and long overdue. And I am very optimistic that this is the turning point. Mm-hmm. I mean, we had prosecutors on Friday, career prosecutors at Trump's Justice Department, say Trump directed the commission of various felonies that are really serious. And I think the time is now. We have to look at it and say, things are changing. People are waking up and realizing what's happening. And this letter, this bipartisan letter, it's in the spirit of so much else. You know, I've had the privilege of writing with George Conway a series of articles about this kind of stuff. And this letter continues that tradition. And that's really the American tradition. So it's really heartwarming to see.
You really think that the tide is turning?
I do. I think that, it's small steps now, but I do think that, as people look at this and understand the gravity of the crime that was committed, and the gravity of things which aren't crimes necessarily, like Trump hiding all this stuff about Russia in 2016, maybe that's not always a crime. But boy, the amount of compromising material that the Russians had, because the Russians knew that he lied to the American people during the campaign and they've held it over him for 2 years. Yeah. This is an astounding thing. And so, yes, you take all of that together. I am very optimistic that that the tide is turning and will continue to.
Let's talk about the accusations here, at least of a crime, John, that Neil mentioned. The president is implicated in two felonies in the Southern District of New York's filing on Michael Cohen. He's trying to downplay the payment, saying it was, quote, simple private transactions. But that's not the case, no matter how hard he tries to spin this.
No. It is not the case. And you know what struck me about some of his defense and some of his defenders have been what they've missed is that several people were given immunity from criminal prosecution to testify in those cases. Weissenbach and Pecker from Weissenbach from the Trump Organization was given use immunity of some sort. Pecker of the National Enquirer was given immunity. You don't give immunity to people who are involved in civil cases, who don't feel the threat of criminal charges being if they go before a grand jury. So this, they just can't dismiss this the way they want to and pretend that it's a civil action or it's equivalent of Obama's actions. Mm-hmm.
I've got to ask you, I want to play this, guys, because this is Senator Chris Coons. He was on with Wolf Blitzer earlier. He is echoing Congressman Adam Schiff that Trump could potentially be indicted after leaving office. Listen to this.
The evidence that's been presented in the Michael Cohen case that the president directed him to engage in payments that were intended to influence the outcome of the election really sharpens the president's legal risk here. And I agree with Congressman Schiff that that might well form the basis for an indictment after the president leaves office.
All right, just to get both of your responses, do you agree with his assessment, Neil?
I absolutely do. So, you know, look, I think, and John's on and knows Watergate, and a lot of people are saying the question that's going to be asked is like, what did Nixon know and when did he know it? Here, I think, precisely for the reasons John's mentioning about immunity, the proper analogy when we think about criminal indictment is actually the mob. And that is increasingly how the White House is looking, like how they're behaving. Mm-hmm. And with the mob investigation, the kind of key thing is, did the leader know about it? Or was he studiously avoiding knowing about certain things? And I think the one thing we can say about Donald Trump is he's not exactly a conscientious student when it comes to the law. Mm-hmm. And I think it's fair to say that he's no Tony Soprano or something like that, who's structuring all his organizations and stuff to necessarily avoid things. He almost certainly knew everything that was going on, and that's the essence of what the sentencing memo on Friday said from career prosecutors, mm-hmm. that Trump directed all of this stuff. Okay. And boy, that is looking like a felony, and a very serious felony. This may be the most significant campaign contribution ever in United States history in terms of swinging an election, these two payments to the women.
I got to get to a break, John, but quickly, do you agree with Senator Coons?
I do.
You do?
I do. I think they're saying what needs to be said,
yeah.
And I'm glad they did.
Well, there are still some Republicans there in Washington who say, oh, so y'all. Okay, so let's talk, Neil, you on this one. I just want your reaction to this. Armanu Raju caught up with Senator Orrin Hatch, and he is dismissing allegations of Trump crimes over hush money. Listen to this.
The Democrats will do anything to hurt this president, anything.
But this is not the Democrats, this is the Southern District of New York, the U.S. Attorney. I mean, that's what's making this allegation.
Okay, but I don't care. All I can say is he's doing a good job as president. I don't think he was involved in crimes, but even then, you know, you can make anything a crime under the current laws. If you want to, you can blow up way out of proportion, you can do a lot of things.
Okay, so it's the Democrats, and then he says, I don't care. And then he said, you can make any, what?
Oh, Lordy, I don't even know where to begin. But there are tapes. So I think the first thing to say about this new thing is that you know, this is very different than the defense we've been hearing for many months. I mean, Trump was asked in April, you know, was asked the following, Mr. President, do you know about the $130,000 payment to Stormy Daniels? Answer, quote, no, ask Michael Cohen about it. So now it's all, oh, no, he did know. But, you know, people violate the law all the time, which is an astounding thing for a senator to say. Even more astounding for a senator, of course, can change the laws so that people aren't all walking around in felons without knowing it. He's wrong about everything about what he just said. This is not some Democratic thing. This is actually career prosecutors in New York who are part of the Trump Justice Department who are saying all of this stuff. This is not even the Mueller team. This is a whole separate team. But at the bottom line, I think what you see happening is the president losing confidence in any one of his defenses. He's changing them constantly, and I think the only words that could be said for that are bait and witch.
he just admitted what I think most Republican congressmen and senators think. Oh, it doesn't matter. I don't really care if he committed crimes. That is the real truth. And I mean, as a voting American or just an American citizen, I wonder what people think about that. I don't care if the president committed crimes, meaning he's above the law, meaning it's all political. That the president doesn't have the same standards as the people who hired him. But John, listen, I got to play this. Orrin Hatch, the most senior GOP senator, and I just want to play what he said. This is about President Clinton a couple of days before he voted on articles of impeachment.
I'm just saying that it's been lying from the beginning. And the person to blame is none other than our president. Now, look, I've been fair to the president. I've been fair to the president. I like the president. But what he's done here is reprehensible.
Well, wait, hold on. I just want to say before, here's what he said in a statement at the time, all right? And this is from the New York Times. This is in 1999. He said, committing crimes of moral turpitude, such as perjury and obstruction of justice, go to the heart of the qualification for office. Hypocrisy much here?
Well, I think he has, I'm close enough to him in age to say that I think he has slipped a lot in the last 19 years. It's kind of sad. I don't think he's thinking things through very clearly, and I think he says the first thing that comes to his mind, and he's in a total defense mode for Trump. He has, not only has he been drinking the Kool-Aid, he's looking for something as he heads into retirement.
I just want to say before you go, just remind me.
I would say that there's something.
Go ahead, Neil.
I was just going to say, you know, I don't think this is really about Senator Orrin Hatch. This is about Donald Trump. Mm-hmm. He is our nation's chief law enforcement officer who takes an oath to uphold the Constitution. He's the one the world looks to for leadership, for mm-hmm. compliance with our most basic values, and this is what he's doing. Yeah. This is not the way any president should behave.
Hey, listen, I'm out of time here, Neil, but I just want to remind folks, you mentioned it earlier, what you did with Kellyanne Conway's husband, George Conway. You recently co-authored an op-ed responding to Trump blaming Democrats, and here's what you write, okay? You said, no, the criminal campaign finance violations were found by professional line prosecutors in a Republican, this is George Conway writing this, in a Republican-controlled United States Department of Justice. It looks like a pretty good case. Kudos to them. Again, George Conway, a Republican, and also Kellyanne Conway's husband. So CNN is learning tonight that Maria Butina, the alleged Russian spy, is cooperating with federal prosecutors after initially not saying a word when she was arrested back in July. Butina is now admitting she conspired with a Russian government official while working here in the U.S. A source saying it's part of a plea deal. So I want to bring in now James Clapper, the former director of intelligence. Good evening to you. My goodness, we hear these things, there are denials, and then all of a sudden there's admissions, and then there's a pleading guilty. So here we go again, Director. What's your read on an alleged Russian spy, Maria Butina, now cooperating with the federal prosecutors?
Well, it's unfortunately, a pattern that seems to be all too familiar. I'll tell you, Don, the thing that struck me, a couple things about this. First of all, this was completely separate from the Mueller investigation. Mm-hmm. Second, I think it reflects the how astute the Russians are about understanding our political ecosystem and their attempts to penetrate conservative groups. And what more important conservative group than the NRA, which the Russians certainly understand has a death grip on many of our politicians. Hmm. So it makes every bit of sense from a Russian perspective that they would want to penetrate the NRO or the NRA to extend their influence. And I think it also interesting, not knowing exactly the terms of the plea agreement, exactly who she was working for and what instructions that she had and how she was financed.
Yeah.
So this is a very interesting and significant development, quite apart from the Mueller investigation.
So listen, I just want to ask you quickly, this is unusual and then get a longer response from you. So by our count, at least 16 Trump associates had contacts with Russians during the campaign of the transition. There we have them up there on the screen, from Paul Manafort to Rick Gates to Flynn, Jeff Sessions, Roger Stone, Caputo, Jerry Kushner's on this list, Ivanka Trump, Felix Sater, Michael Cohen, and on. Is that unusual first?
Oh, I think it certainly is. I don't know of any precedent for this at all. And this is what's bugged me from the outset of all this, is why all this contact with the Russians, of all people, our arch adversary. And of course, as more and more of this is unfolded, and we're now more and more aware of these additional contacts, you know, the plot thickens.
Well, that's what I want to ask you. Why were they all so willing to have these meetings, these contacts, or Russian help? And why did some of them lie about those contacts?
Well, obviously, that's the question. Why did the president try to why did he lie about his dealings with the Russians? And certainly, he is aware, I am quite sure, quite confident, he was aware of all these other contacts. And so what was the point? Was it just to make money? Trump Tower in Moscow, I guess something he's long wanted to do. Was there in fact an offer of a $50 million penthouse to Putin? This is not good. It says a whole lot about the ethics or lack thereof of this administration and this president.
Director, let's talk about the former FBI director James Comey. Okay, he was interviewed in front of a live audience at New York City's 92nd Street Y, and he was asked whether he thinks if he thinks the lying is catching up with Trump. Here's his answer.
I can't see what the end of the Mueller effort looks like. I don't know what form it will take. I don't know what they'll conclude. And so I can't say in that respect. I can tell you that all of us should use every breath we have to make sure that the lying stops on January 20th, 2021.
Interesting. I mean, you have to admit it is pretty remarkable, a remarkable thing to hear from a former head of the FBI, especially when another former FBI director, Mueller, is leading an investigation that involves the president.
Well, it is. And I think Jim makes a good point. I mean, this has been his position from the outset as well, that the only satisfactory way to resolve this is at the polling place. Impeachment, and there seems to be a gathering storm for that, just from recent developments. But I think, however an impeachment came out, whether it was successful, that is a conviction on the part of the Senate or not, all that would do is heighten the polarization and divisiveness in this country that is already pretty bad. And I think the only way ahead here the most optimistic way ahead would be the
search is on for a new White House chief of staff, and with General Kelly expected to leave the administration at the end of the year, the president doesn't have much time. Nick Ayers, the chief of staff for Vice President Pence, widely considered the top candidate for the job, he took himself out of consideration on Sunday. So let's discuss. Chris Saliz is here, Kirsten Powers. Chris, wasn't this fake news that John Kelly's happy and not going anywhere?
Yes. I mean, look, it doesn't take you all that long to go back through Donald Trump's quotes and tweets in which he says, General Kelly and I have talked and he'll be staying through 2020. Now, we, of course, knew at the time that was solely Trump being reactive to news saying he had tired of Kelly, which, by the way, in retrospect, was 100% accurate, like most of the things he calls fake news. And he just goes back on it. He says things in the moment to try to counter things that are true and yeah. play to his base.
But it says, our source is saying, super pissed, right? Super pissed that Ayers, I don't know why I hate that word. I have such an aversion to that word. Said that Ayers said no, right? And so he has no plan B. It's just a testament to just how chaotic this White House
Yeah, I mean, I actually think a lot of times when you hear officials quoted on background, you know, a senior administration official, and they poo-poo something that then happens, I actually don't think that they're lying or trying to mislead. I think it is the nature of this White House that he, Donald Trump, changes his mind very quickly, often, I would say, in reaction to press coverage. Yeah. And therefore, this move, he will move on to something else and say this was always the plan. But make no mistake, on Sunday night, this time yesterday, Don, Nick Ayers was likely to be the guy. He takes himself out in a big surprise. It doesn't play out the way Trump wants. The narrative is this guy walked away from me. He doesn't like that. That makes him mad. He'll move on to the next person. And as he tweeted last night, oh, well, this is all part of the plan. I'm interviewing people. It's fake news that I want Nick Ayers. It's not fake news. Remember, fake news for him means news I don't like.
Yeah.
Not actual fake news.
When people actually catch me in a lie. Okay, so let's, I just want to play. This is the president back in March, by the way. Let's play this.
So many people want to come in. I have a choice of anybody. I could take any position in the White House, and I'll have a choice of the 10 top people having to do with that position. Everybody wants to be there.
Now we know that's really not the case, is it?
No, it's definitely not the case.